Hello? Hold on. Well, just waiting on Wendy, everybody. He's having some technical issues right now. Weird, I don't know why I can't hear her. Oh, got off the call, that's why. Why am I mute? Am I muted in Discord too? What the heck? Oh, it doesn't say I'm muted. La da da la da da la da da la da da. I have some neat things to show. Whenever Wendy's gets back. Oh boy. What's going on with her? Nothing is loading, not even Discord. Oh fuck. All this could have been averted if we probably just played on Tabletop Simulator. So, today we're going to be playing on Commander for Magic. The Commander format of Magic the Gathering. And we're going to be playing on Spell Table. Here's the problem. Is that oftentimes my camera has issues with starting up, which is why I started streaming so late from what my schedule was, and oftentimes there are technical difficulties like these, and Wendy is having those technical difficulties. Bonk. Ah, what did I do? Kitaro, bro, what's up? Hydrate. Okay, let me grab a bottle of water. Wendy is having some bad luck. There should be a rule against my friend's stream so early. Well, here's the thing, is that this was not my idea. Wendy was the one that wanted to stream together early today because she had a lot of things to do later, and she didn't want that to conflict with us playing together today. Here she is. Blame her. Are you there, babe?
Huh?
Are you there?
Yes.
You sound distant.
Distant.
Yeah, you sound distant. I think you're cutting out, babe. Better. And Kitaro says we're streaming too early.
12? Too bad.
What mic are you? You sound different than your normal mic.
I think it's picking up from the
from
camera.
What?
I don't but
oh my god, you're like cutting out in and out kind of bad. Holy crap.
Any better?
Better, I don't know. It's just... Is it the webcam?
Yeah.
mic? Because I think it's the webcam mic. I think you got your mics mixed up.
It shouldn't have changed.
Did you check your... Okay, so here's what you want to do. Go to the game menu settings and go to configure inputs.
How about now?
There we go. That sounds sexy. Alrighty. I think we're good to switch things over. Give me one sec. I need to do a couple things real quick before I can switch over to the game scene. Uh-oh, I didn't want to exit out of that. Fuck, I messed up. Anyways, too late now. Should I do it this way? Should I do it that way? Do it this way. I guess I can do it this way. Yeah, I can do it this way. Alrighty then. Let us switch this over. Uh-oh. Yeah, I do not like this one. Okay, give me one second. How about... Probably have to do with the old overlay. Yeah, this is better. Do you remember how to set up your commander and everything? Y'all's matching PNGs are great. Thank you. They were done by Moobell. Awesome friend. And great artist. Highly recommend them. And... I need to lock this. Oh, it is locked. Why is everything so good? Like, everywhere. Alright, so... Under your name, click add commander.
I just did. I kind of remembered a little bit.
Oh, so you're lying to me now.
I'm not lying. It just came back to me at the very last second.
And I do not know. Should I do it in the four-way, Matt? Yeah, do it this way. This one seems a little... better. And expand. Oh, I was gonna say, what am I doing? Where do I put? Yeah, I guess I could put chat here. See if this works. I'm trying to do a lot. Don't want to move that. Oh, I hope I didn't move that. I moved it. There we go. Stop it. Okay. Got a little more. Go over here a little more. You're so adorable with your blinky eyes. So, okay, this should work. Should work. Hopefully. My camera a little crooked. There we go. And before we begin, I actually have a little surprise to do because... One, fuck my pharmacy, and two, it allowed me to have enough money to splurge a little bit.
One, two, three. Ah.
It's funny that I toss those, and there's a potential $1,500 card in one of these. You there, babe?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. Surprise unboxing. So how's your day been, Wendy?
Been pretty good. How's yours been?
Moderately okay. You know, you already know the situation about my pharmacy dicking me over. Work was fine today. Can't complain. Even though we didn't have as many people as we should on a Monday. Well, then again, it was a slow day, so I guess it was fine. So what I have here are three collector booster pack boxes. And they all have one collector booster pack. And oftentimes, these collector boosters have goodies in them that cover the cost for the entire pack itself. Not all the time, but oftentimes. Got a little foil construct there. Nice. Ooh, a power stone. That's cool. Alright, let's start with this. These packs, normally all the goodie stuff is in the back, and I see a foil for a Transformers card. Oh, fuck, it's Goldbug again. Sort of the Meek foil. This is actually a real good card. It has two to play out, and it has equipped creature has +1/+2. Whenever a 1/1 creature enters the battlefield under your control, you may return Sword of the Meek from your graveyard to the battlefield, then attach it to a creature. That's actually pretty good, considering if you play a token deck, and you can just, hey, it's one of the creatures you have, babe. Burnished Heart. Foil Chromatic Star. Wire Surgeons. Fear. For each artifact creature your card in your graveyard has Encore. Its Encore cost is equal to its mana cost. Ooh. Ooh, that's sexy. That is a full art. No, that's not even a pain land. Which land is that? As this enters the battlefield, you may reveal a soldier from your hand. Enter the battlefield unless you reveal a soldier. Okay. Oh, the dual land, but with benefits. Nice. Oh, shit. That's another good card. Fade from History. It's a 2/2 green, so it's a 4 drop. Each player who controls an artifact or enchantment creates a 2/2 bear. Then destroy all artifacts and enchantments. We got a nice foil showcase land. And a bunch of other foils. I gotta look up the price for this guy. Because I know that his regular version is cheap as fuck, but foil versions often have better prices to them. Especially the showcase art or the shattered glass art for the Transformers cards. If you get a shattered glass one, they're like, depending on the card, is like $15 to $25. But if you get the shiny foil ones, they're like hundreds, if not thousands of dollars. And those are rare to get. And what's cool about it, though, is that even though they're rare to get, you're still guaranteed a Transformers card in these booster boxes, or booster packs. Oh, I don't think this one's fastened tightly, so that could be a problem. Yeah, I don't like it. So, back in Strixhaven, which was about a year ago, they actually had, like, I think that was the last collector booster that they did, that they actually had, like, a fastened case for the pack, and that was just, hey, put glue stickers to fasten down these overpriced packs. Got a nice little soldier there. Another Power Stone token. And... ooh, what the hell is this one? Astro... Cornucopia. When Astro Cornucopia enters the battlefield with X charge counters on it, choose a color, add one mana of color for each charge counter. Ooh! I have to look up the price on that. That's badass. Oh, hey, this is the first new Transformer card I got. Nikolanus, the Saboteur. Teen Stone, Foundry Inspector. Ooh, what's this one? Oh, it's another Foundry Inspector, but this one's a foil. Oh, what do they call this card? Schematic art. Doctor Shop. Whenever one or more artifact creature you control dies, draw a card. This ability triggers only once each turn. Nice. Ooh, this one's actually a fun commander that people have been excited for. Liberator, Urza's Battleflopter. Has flash, has flying, and gives all artifacts you control flash. So you can play any artifact spell for whenever you want to. Hagar, Loyal Bodyguard, Sacrifice Hagar, Loyal Bodyguard, Legendary Creatures you control get +1/+0, and an indestructible until end of turn. Pretty neat. Especially for a 2-drop. And now for the last one. So one here, you should be playing your deck on your tablet.
What?
Are you going to be playing your deck on your tablet?
Yes.
All right, final pack. I don't like I think the foiling for some of the cards have not been done well enough, because there's some ones that look nicked. And you can see it because, you know those, weird little sheets of paper in art class you get, and all you have to do is scratch on the black sheet of paper, and it erases the... shavings to reveal, like, there's, like, actual, like, gold or silver underneath it. That's what some of the foiling looks like when it gets scratched. Oh, shit! And it's a schematic, too. Ramos, Dragon Engine. It's a 5-color commander, but it's an artifact creature. Oh. And schematic one, too. I saw this. So this was like a $25 card. And it's foil. Actually, I need it. I need to look it up now. Slicer Hired Muscle. I actually ordered him. Black Blade Reforged. This one's actually a good one, too. Elsewire Flask. What's this one do? When it enters, draw a card. Sacrifice it. Choose a basic land. Each land you control becomes a type until... ooh, that's nice. Ooh, this is another Burnished Heart, but this one's a schematic foil version. Nice. Artificer's Dragon. Oh, so it's basically Shivan Dragon, but an artifact dragon. Nice. Holy shit! I got Gix! I got a Gix! And a showcase too. Oh my god. Saving that. The Stone Brain. Exile the Stone Brain. Choose a card name. Search target opponent's graveyard, hand, or library for up to 4 cards with that name and exile them. That player. Oh, that's a dick move card. Nice. Argiven, Adventure, Disenchant, the printing on is askew, ruin the, you see the printing, you can see like the black border there is thicker than the black border in this here. Gix sounded like something else at first. Gix, dicks, well Gix is a dick, just for record. He's the one that turned, Urza's brother, Mishra, into a Phyrexian. And essentially controlled, Mishra into continuing the bloody war with, Urza. Hence why it was called the Brothers' War. Jenna! Kitty! Good kitty. But no, this is a really good card, because, another cool thing about a spell table is that when you click on a card, it registers, the art, and, oh, kitty! Oh, Jenna, you're so cute!
Yep, just walking all over the place.
I mean, you could stop her at any time.
I could, but I'm afraid she'll grab something in the attempt.
And, here's Gix, and this is what he does, is like, whenever a creature deals damage to one or more opponents, its controller may pay 1 life, and if they do, they can draw a card. And then Gix has a secondary ability where you have to pay 4 and 3 black, so you have to pay 7 mana, and discard X cards. Exile the top X cards of a target opponent's library. And you may play lands and cast spells from among them without paying their mana cost. So you can quite literally steal your opponent's deck with this card. And it's only a 3 drop too. God, I cannot wait to pull him into a Phyrexian deck. I really want to look up these prices right now. Like, hold on. Because these things are not cheap. So like, fortified beachhead. What else? What was the other one? Ramos. Yeah, it was Ramos. Where did he go? Funny, I actually have a friend with the last name Ramos. There he is. Dragon engine. Oh, it's a dragon engine too. I wasn't paying attention to the name, but Dragon Engine is kind of significant because that's what Mishra used for his army to go against his brother, Urza, because the two of them were artifact people and artificers, and so they would always use like automatons and robots and whatnot to go to war with each other with, and actually some of the land art, like this one right here, that's an example of the giant automatons they would go to war with one another with. It's just literally a giant robot standing above the ocean. Kind of like Gypsy Danger from Pacific Rim. That's a good analogy right there. But yeah, give me 1 second, because I really want to look up these prices, because I know these things are worth a pretty penny at the moment. Or at least on the website that I use. Because Gix, last I checked, was the 3rd most expensive card on Card Kingdom. So yeah, Card Kingdom. If it loads, Gix, Yawgmoth Praetor. Yep. Yep, the version I have is $25. Hell yeah. So then, what about fortified, beachhead? Which sounds sexual. Oh, it's not worth that much. It's like $1.29. I could have just bought that by itself. But Ramos Dragon Engine, though.
Jenna.
Get her, kitty. Yep. It is worth $20, but it's not. Oh, actually, no. Wait, this one's just the. This isn't the foil one. Now, how much is the foil one? Holy shit! Holy shit. $40. That's a great pull. $25 card and a $40 card. What about, what was it called? What was I looking for? Fade from History. What is a Fade from History cost? Because I know it's an expensive card right now. Oh, it's not. Get the fuck out of here. You're telling me that it went from one of the best board wipes ever from the set to being an 80 cent card? How much is the foil? No fucking price difference. God damn it. Oh, please tell me I have like something else. How much is Goldbug? How much is the foil version of Goldbug? I don't think it's that much either. From his normal price, because I remember setting him up in, Moxfield for my Optimus Prime deck, and his foil version wasn't that much different. Yes, it's a dollar difference. So yeah. Outside of that, I don't think I got that much that were interesting, that were good per se, but a lot of them were really, really, neat. What is Astro Cornucopia? It has an interesting cost to it, because it's, you have to pay X, you have to pay X, and you have to pay X. And it's, oh, it's only a $2 card. What the fuck? Okay, but what's the foil cost? Still $2. You gotta be fucking kidding me. Wow. Rip. Liberator. Birds is Battlethopter. It's a $4 card. That's not bad. Huh. Not the greatest pull, I think. Well, I wouldn't say that. I got a $40 card out of this, and I wasn't really expecting it. What? Nope, not that one. This one. Pop. Alrighty. I just need to find sleeves now for these, because these are... Oh, wait. I have sleeves. Minx! Welcome! Long time no see. Welcome to the stream. We're just messing around. And I am just... sleeving expensive cards. This is going into my Phyrexian deck. I'm so happy I pulled this one, because I'm waiting for a 5-color Phyrexian deck to come out in the new Phyrexia set in February. Yes, February. And everyone's hoping that that set is going to have a 5-color commander, which
They have to. They legally have to at this point with all the crap that they've been pulling with the new Phyrexians and everything. I'll just set these aside for now. No input, no comments, no questions, Wendy. Silence?
Nope. Oh, God.
What?
Jenna.
Get her, kitty. Make her, make her participate. Alright, I'm gonna be using cats. Wendy's gonna be using Negan. And for those who are not aware, I know Kitaro does not know how to play. We're going to be playing Magic the Gathering, and we're going to be playing the Commander format. Now, what is Commander? Commander is a 100-deck singleton format, meaning every card in your deck has to be at least one copy. There cannot be any more than that. Unless there are specific cards that work around the rule. Outside of that, there is the legendary rule, which you can't have more than one copy of the same legendary card, but you can have you can pick a special legendary creature to represent your deck. And you can build your deck around that legendary commander and the theme. So mine is based around cats. Wendy's, however, is based around an aristocrat strategy, meaning it's all about sacrificing and sending creatures to the graveyard for a bigger payoff, whether it be my own creatures or her own. And she's going to be playing Negan from The Walking Dead. And it was a God damn it. Give me a moment. And it was a collaboration event between The Walking Dead and Wizards of the Coast. And Wendy loves Negan, and so I made her a Negan deck about a year ago. Was it a year ago? I think it was. Because I didn't get into Magic at the Gathering until like last year. Like, I'm literally only a year into this hobby. And so, Magic the Gathering is a old but yet simple game to play. You have what you call resource lands, or just lands in general, which produce resources, aka mana, to be able to play a card. And how you know what card to play for each land is kind of in the artwork. So, for example, my commander is Arable, Roar of the Worlds. Or Roar of the World. And he costs 3 and 1 green and 1 white, meaning that he costs 5 to play out. But, the 3 means it can be a mana of any color. However, the 1 green and the 1 white mean it has to be 1 forest and 1 plains to pay for him being cast out. And that applies to generally all cards. And mine is just a cat-centric deck where most strategies that I use for my magic decks, or my commander decks at least, all are about beating the fuck out of anyone. So, it's called the beat face strategy, while other people have more complex strategies like blue players. Me, however, no. I just like beating the crap out of people.
Even his own girlfriend.
This is true, even though your deck should be able to counter most of my stuff. Or at least... Oh, and you might want to get a notepad out or something, babe, at halftime. Because, if we're... kind of want to do this a little properly with Negan. So, when... I got bonked. No! So whenever you play Negan out and activate his ability, you're going to have to write down the target of the name of one of my creatures, and then a friend of mine in my magic group who goes against our Negan player, he just says the name before the name of what's written down is revealed, because he doesn't want to waste paper. So is that alright with you?
It sounds like a pain in the butt.
It's only pen and paper, babe.
Yeah, well, for cost money, just use Psy. If that's okay with you.
Yeah, I guess you can send it, use Psy and then, like, send it in Discord to me, I guess, yeah. So, what happens in Magic, you have to roll dice to determine who goes first. And since it's a 1v1 format right now, and not a multiplayer one like how Commander normally is, one of us will not be able to draw on our first turn, depending on who goes first. I rolled a 14.
I rolled an 8.
8 or an 18?
18.
Okay. So do you want to go first or do you want to go second?
I'd like to go second.
Okay, so then I'll draw my 7. Actually, this is a bit of a house rule thing. I do it with my magic group. You draw 10 and then you put 3 in the bottom of your deck and keep whatever you want. So do you want to do that, babe, or do you want to just draw 7?
I'll just draw 7.
Alright, let's draw 7 then. 4, 5, 6, and 7. Alrighty. Oh, I do not like this hand. I do not like this hand at all. Yep. I'm gonna mulligan. And you okay?
Sorry. I just dropped my card, that's all.
Get it, Jenna.
No, she might ruin it.
Well, hopefully it's not one of the expensive cards I put in that deck. So for record, you can check my Mox field, but my Cats deck is like $400, roughly, while Wendy's, Negan deck is like $200. Which that doesn't really always determine the power level of which is better, but it gives you a rough estimate of what to expect per se when it comes to those kind of budgets. So I'm gonna draw 7 more. And the first, so what Mulligan does is that you can just put away the 7 cards you don't want back into your deck and draw another 7, and the first mulligan is free, but if I were to want to mulligan another time, I would have to put 1 card from my hand back, so I would have to start off with a 6 card hand instead of a 7 one. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 6 and 7. And yeah, I guess I'll go with this. This is better than nothing. How about you, babe?
I'm good.
You're good? Alright, then I'll start us off. I'll be playing a forest for turn, and I'll pass. And for Magic the Gathering, when you're playing lands, you can only play one land per turn unless you have a card that works around that.
I'll be playing a swamp.
Swamp. Yeah, swamp.
Was I supposed to draw first?
Yes.
Sorry. And I pass.
Alrighty. I'll go ahead and draw. And then I will play a Sun Petal Grove. It comes in untapped, so long as I control a forest or a plains, and I control forest, so it comes in untapped. And then I will tap for two, one green and one color of any, and play out a Hungry Lynx. And it has, cats I control have protection from rats, and at the beginning of my end step, so at the end of my turn, I can give an opponent one black rat creature with death touch. And whenever a rat dies, put a 1/1 counter on a cat creature I control. So, have nothing else to do, and so I'll be going to the end of my turn, and then give Wendy a rat.
That made my brain hurt.
So pretty much at the end of my turn, I can give you a rat.
Okay.
Which is supposed to be like a group hug kind of a situation where it makes you think I'm giving you beneficial stuff, but really I'm not. It's a trick. So I'm giving you a rat, and you, if you want, on your turn, since I just made that rat for you on my turn, you can try to attack me with that rat if you want.
Okay.
All right, and so your turn, babe. Brando XY, thank you for coming. Gonna buff himself. Pretty much, that's the purpose of Hungry Lynx.
I use Blighted Fen. I think I can use this card.
Can you push your card up a little further so I can... I don't remember putting that in your deck. Blighted Fen, add one mana of any color. Sacrifice Blighted Fen by paying 4 and 1 black. For your opponent... Ooh. That's actually a good card. Yeah, so right now, all you can do is pay 1 black and 1 color, yeah, 1 of 1 generic. Do you have anything that's a 2 drop right now?
I do. Grim something. Okay, that's my turn.
Grim Harlspex, more if you may cast this card face down as a 2/2 creature for 3. Turn it face up anytime it morphs. Whenever another non-token creature you control dies. Ooh, draw card. That's actually a good one. That's an example of an aristocrat strategy. You know, you want creatures to die in order to benefit from its effects. Alright, go ahead and tap. Draw. Ooh. Okay. Play a forest for turn. And I will play out... Ooh, who should I play this turn? I don't want to. Oh, man. Alright. Tap for a white, tap for a green, and tap for another color of any. Could play out Miri Weatherlight Duelist. She has First Strike, and whenever Miri Weatherlight Duelist attacks, each opponent can't block with more than one creature. And whenever she's tapped, opponents can only attack with one creature. So, I am going to send Hungry Lynx at you, babe. And then I'm going to have a trigger off of Arabo because he has Eminence. And his Eminence ability says, at the beginning of combat on my turn, if Arabo is in the command zone or on the battlefield, another target cat I control gets +3/+3 until end of turn. So this is gonna buff Hungry Lynx +3/+3, and it's going to be a 5/5 coming your way, babe.
Hmm. Okay.
You gotta take it?
Yeah.
Alrighty. So that knocks you down to 35. And I'll be passing my turn, and that will give you another rat. Your go.
I play a mountain card. Yeah, that's it.
You don't have a 3-drop or anything?
No.
Oh, boy.
And I don't want to attack you, so I pass my turn.
Oh, then I'm gonna end up picking on you then. Because that's the whole point of this deck. Alright. Draw. After my untap. Canopy Vista. I control more than two basic lands. Alright, two or more basic lands. And it comes in untapped. We'll play. Who do I play next? Yeah, I guess I'll do this one. White, green, two more of any color. Gonna be playing out a Johnny the Greatbeard. And Johnny has creatures I control have vigilance, so meaning that they don't tap when I go to attack now. And he has a +1 of gain 3 life, and then has a -2 of put a 1/1 counter on each creature you control, and a loyalty counter on each planeswalker I control. Not including him. So, I'm going to uptick him for a +1, and I'll be right back, because I need to grab my special dice for this. I always put my planeswalker counters in my werewolf deck case. So his loyalty counters are at 6 now, and I gain 3 life. 1, 2, and 3. And then I will go ahead and send Mir your way, and I'm going to have the Arabo trigger. And she's going to gain +3/+3, and now she's going to be a 6/5 going your way.
Any chance I can block with those rats?
Nope, because all my cats have protection from rats. So, It even says it right here under Hungry Lynx. They can't be blocked, targeted, or dealt damage by rats.
Okay.
So you,
I'll take it.
Are you sure? Because you have a Grim Horse Vex that you can block with if you want.
Choo-choo. I know, but I'd just be losing a card.
True. So you're gonna be taking the 6?
Yes.
Alrighty. And then you'll be knocked down to 29. And then, at the end of my turn, you get a rat. And then, I shall pass.
I play Blightstep Pathway.
Oh, I was wondering where that card was. I knew I had that card somewhere. I guess I gave it to you. Oh, you might want to check your mana fixing before that, because that's a double-sided card for a reason.
It is?
Yep. Basically, it's a swamp on one side and a mountain on the other, so you might want to check what colors you need. I think it's a swamp. It's the Rakdos land. Rats! Rats! We are the rats! Yes, we are.
I want to play its other side.
Okay. I'll allow it.
Get around real quick. Okay. That's all I've got. I passed my turn.
How do you not have anything, even though it's the color that you want?
Because the card I have costs a lot.
How much do they cost? Because there's only...
Four and two mountains.
Four and two mountains. Okay, that's 6. What about everything else?
I don't have anything else.
What? So wait, what's in
I
your...
have nothing but land and one monster.
Oh my god. Oh no! Okay. Oh no, I feel bad now. Ugh.
Can I pass my turn?
Sure. How do you end up with a better land count than me, but I like, can't play any of that?
Bad luck?
Something. Holy crap. Hey, look. Plains. After my untaps up, and I top decked that shit. Oh boy. Oh no. I really hope my strategy doesn't come up to play. So... going to... Was this enter the battlefield? Yeah, it's an enter the battlefield effect. Oh no. Oh no, that's mean. Okay. Okay, I'll do this. Alright, Canopy of Yves stuff for a white. Sun Petal Grow for a white. And Plains for, you know, mana of any color. Gonna play out another Ajani Planeswalker card. Ajani, Caller of the Pride. He has +1. Play 1/1 counter on a target creature I control. -3, target creature gains flying and double strike until end of turn. Or -8, put X 2/2 white cat creature tokens onto the battlefield where X is the number equal to my life total. And I'm gonna +1 them. I'm gonna put a 1/1 counter on Miri. So he's gonna be up to 5. And then I'm going to give Miri the 1-1 counter, which I thought I had. I think they're in this bag. Yeah, they're in this bag. A 1-1 counter. So she is currently a 4-3. And then I'm going to minus 2 this other Ajani. And that'll increase this Ajani's loyalty counter by 1. This will give Miri another +1/+1. And this will give my Lynx another, a first time +1/+1. Where is the die for it? Yep, here it is. And so I will have Miri and Hungry Lynx go your way. Gonna be a trigger off Arabo and gonna give Miri +3/+3. So we have a 3-3, a 6-3+2. Be a 8. Oh god, that's an 8-7? Yeah, it's a 8-7. So you have basically 11 damage going your way.
Can I?
You cannot.
Block with him?
Yes, you can. I would highly encourage it. Block Miri.
Okay.
All right. Now, because of
how much damage am I taking?
You will be taking 3.
Goes into my graveyard now.
Yep. And then after that, I will pass, and then you will get another. Rat. And I think that's actually all my rat tokens.
Okay.
And then I'll pass.
I play a Plains.
Let's go.
Think I can use Negan now?
Actually, you can. Let me see. He's a 5-drop. Yes, he is. Yeah, you can play Negan.
Yay!
You have to tap out, though, first.
Okay, that's all.
Well, he has his enter the battlefield effect. Bad hand, ouch. Yeah, bad hand indeed. So, go into Psy, pick who you want to be executed by Negan, and then send it to me after just send it to me and let me know, and I'll pick who I will want to be executed.
Don't know how to spell their name, and I can't. For some reason, it doesn't pop up like it should.
Lynx Miri. M-I-R-R-I.
And send it to you on Discord?
Yeah. When Negan enters the battlefield, you and target opponent each secretly choose a creature that player controls. So if I had, like, hexproof on myself, then Negan wouldn't work on me. Okay.
Okay. I pass my turn now.
Wait. There's still a bunch of stuff.
There is?
Yeah, because I have to sacrifice. So I'll pick who I want to be executed. And I'll pick Miri. Because she's actually pretty fucking broken right now. And you picked Miri too. Okay. So Miri dies, ends up sacrificed, and because of Negan's effect, you get a treasure token. Honestly, babe, you could have probably swung at me with all those rats and actually started chip away at my health. Because I can only block one at a time.
It's a little late for that though, isn't it?
Yep. Next time. And my turn, draw. Oh my god. Getting all my pieces. There's no way this is gonna fucking work. I'll be damned if this works. A white, green, any color, and any color, but your Lynx would have been buffed if she did that. Yeah, but only by one though, because if I would have blocked one rat, the rat would have died. It would have buffed my Lynx. However, that would just allow me at the end of my turn to give her another rat. And then she would still have the same amount and start continuously chipping away at my health. Though, I can swing on her and she wouldn't be able to block with the rats, but with Negan. But Negan, wouldn't he? He'd be enough to kill me. No, actually, he wouldn't. So she'd only be able to block with Negan. Anyways, that's besides the point. Tapped out for 5. Another Johnny card. A Johnny, Mentor of the Heroes. He has a +1, where distribute 3 1/1 counters among 1, 2, or 3 creatures I control. Look at the top 4. Another +1. Look at the top 4 cards in my library. You may reveal an aura, creature, or planeswalker card from among them, and then put the rest in the bottom of my deck, and put that one revealed card into my hand. And then he has a -8. I gain 100 life. So I will +1 this Ajani. Giving him 7. And give Lynx a 1/1 counter. Now +1 Johnny. I don't know which one if I want the... I guess I'll look at top 4. Be at 5. 1, 2, 3. 4. Yeah, I guess this will work. I will reveal a Stalking Leonin and put the rest of the bottom of my deck. And I will -2 this Johnny. And give him another loyalty counter, and give him another loyalty counter. And this will gain another +1/+1. So babe, do you want to know the strategy with these 3 Ajani's at least? Isn't it?
Sorry. Sure.
So the whole purpose is pretty much to get all their ultimates off, or at least these two, because this one helps increase their loyalty counters to get to their ultimates. And so if I get his ultimate off first, I'll gain 100 life. And if I get his ultimate off after, I'll gain that many cat tokens equal to my life total. Do you get it?
I think so.
So he gives me 100 life. He gives me cat creatures equal to how much life I have.
Okay.
You get it?
Yes.
Okay. So I'm gonna have a Hungry Lynx attack you. And then a Robo trigger, and you have an 8-8 coming your way.
I'll take the hit.
Oof. Alright, you'll be knocked down to 18. And at the end of my turn, you get another rat, which I'm out of rat tokens. So you get... keep track for you. Do I have that many cat creatures? Sort of. I have a shit ton of cat tokens, that's for sure. Your turn, babe.
Okay. Play a swamp.
You have enough for that 6 drop now.
Yeah, but I'm not gonna play that one just yet.
Okay.
And I equip Negan with Lucille.
So, okay, so you have to... Did you tap out for that?
Yes.
So you... Where... Okay, show me your tapped cards.
This one's also tapped. I just played it.
Alright, you tapped for 2, and okay, you 4 more. Okay, so you equipped it. Those 4 lands right there should be, tapped as well, since the equip cost is 4, babe.
That looks like a 1.
Look at the bottom, babe. Yep. You have to pay to equip. I think I gave you Sigarda's aid so you didn't have to worry about that workaround. But yes, you now have that. And...
I think a walker token.
Oh, so, okay, so what you want to do first is attack with Negan. And this is going to help pump you. So do you want...
Can I attack with everything?
Yes, you can.
I'd like to.
Okay. So what... So declare what you're attacking, because these fuckers, if they go off next turn, you're in deep doo-doo. However, Negan has Menace, and I only have 1 creature. So creatures with Menace can only be blocked by... 2 or more creatures. I only have 1 creature. And then you have 5 rats to ping these guys with. Then in any more, you can, like, just hit me.
I wanted to hit you.
Do you want to hit me?
That really confused me.
Do you want to hit me with everything, or do you want to hit me with a little bit and then knock these guys down a peg or two?
I guess I'll just hit you with a little bit.
Okay, so declare who you want to hit me with.
Negan.
So Negan, and that's it? The rest go to my planeswalkers?
Yes.
Okay, so you have 5 rat tokens. How many is going to what?
Uh,
Actually, no, wait. Let me read Lucille one more time. Whenever equipped creature attacks... so it wouldn't even matter because I would have to sacrifice my links because of Lucille. And then you create a treasure token because of Negan. And then you create a walker token after that.
I'm so confused.
This is the stuff you have to keep track of, babe. You're attacking me with Lucille equipped to Negan. That's going to make me sacrifice my links. It says it right there. Whenever you attack with that equipped to a creature, defending player has to sacrifice. And Negan's whole shtick is to gain treasure from your opponent sacrificing a creature. Which is beneficial for you, because the more mana you have, the more stuff you can play out. And on top of that, Lucille can create a walker token now, which you just put it out. But it cannot attack this turn, because it has summoning signals. So basically, you can hit me for a lot right now, or how much you want. Because you're wanting to hit me for 6 with Negan. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And that's commander damage as well. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So where are the rats going to? How are you dividing them?
One of the rats... Two each, except for the third card. That one will only have one. I only have 5 rats.
What I would recommend you do is send 2 rats at this Ajani so we can lower him down for at least 2 turns before I can actually ult him. And then send 2 of these this way. That will kill this one. And then one this way, so it'll be just going back a step. And it'll be 3 turns before I can get off his ultimate.
That's what I said.
I was confused.
I just wasn't specific. I'm sorry.
You have to be specific, because I thought you were talking about, like, having one only do damage this way. So, dead. Knock down to 6. And then knock down to 5. And then Negan should be tapped, I think. Yeah, Negan should be tapped. And so should the rats now. Anything else for you?
Nope. I'm good.
Okay. And alright, so it'll be my turn. Untap. Draw. Oh, great. Where were the hell was this when I needed it? Crap in a hat. I do not like this. I do not like this. Before 5. God, I wish I had this earlier. It would have made things a lot easier for me. I don't like it. It's going to die. Ugh. 1, 2, 3. Stalking Leonin. Going to plus one this Ajani. Look at the top four of my cards. 2, 3, 4. And what was it? Reveal four creature or planeswalker. And then I'll reveal a adorned pouncer and put it into my hand. Ah, man, I should have did that better. Because now I have to wait until next turn to play it out now. And when Stalking Leonin enters the battlefield, secretly choose an opponent. Well, I can't really secretly choose it since I only have one. So I'll choose Wendy. And reveal that player who chose you. So whenever you attack me, I can choose a creature that you're going to attack me with and exile it. So I'll pass my turn.
I play a swamp. These are already tapped. I'll leave them that way.
Oh, why are you leaving your lands tapped?
Because I don't want to retap them.
Oh, because of the six drop?
Yeah.
Ah, shit. Please tell me he doesn't have haste. I don't think he has haste.
I think he does. And I attack you with my walker.
You're only attacking me with the walker.
Well, you said you could exile a card, so I'm assuming it's your pick, right?
Yeah, okay. I understand. Exile a target creature attacking, yeah. So then I'll exile the walker. So it at least saves myself for at least one turn. Are you only attacking the walker, or you also want to attack the rats too, because you also have the rats.
Yeah, I guess I could attack with the rats.
Alright, are you going to attack me or the planeswalkers?
Walkers.
Alright, how are you divvying up?
Three for the left card. Yeah. And two for the other.
Okay. So I will throw my Leonin in front of a rat token, killing one of your rats, and the rest go through. And bring these down to four. Anything else?
Nope. I pass.
Okay. Untap, draw. I'm gonna play an Unclaimed Sanctuary, and I'm gonna name Cats.
You're gonna what?
Name Cats. It says when Unclaimed Sanctuary. I'm sorry. That's the wrong one. When Unclaimed Territory enters the battlefield, choose a creature type, cats, and add one colorless or generic to my mana, or add one mana of any color to cast creature spells of that type. So, cats.
Ah, oh, okay.
So, going to 1, 2, Adorned Pouncer, and then going to plus one this Ajani. Look at the top four. One, two, three, and four. I do not have anything else I have to reveal, so they go into the bottom of my deck. suckish because they were good cards too. And then one. Oh shit! Where's my land? One, two, and three. Going to cast Mage's Attendant, and then when she enters, she creates a token. She creates a 1/1 blue wizard, and it has sacrifice this creature, counter target non-creature spell unless you pay one. And that's all I can do. Yes. Look at all them lands.
I know, there's so many. I play Snow-Covered Mountain. And... tap it. Two, or maybe it's just one. I think it's one. And play something Cutthroat.
Zulaport Cutthroat. One and one generic. Oh, it's one black and one generic. Whenever Zulaport Cutthroat or another creature you control dies, each opponent loses one life and you gain one life. God damn, this really is an aristocrat deck. Okay. Gonna hurt.
I attack with Negan.
Oh boy.
The Primal Storm.
Oh no.
And the rat.
Okay. So first, in response to the Lucille trigger, I will sacrifice the wizard token. And for the Etele, Primal Storm trigger, I will exile. Oh no, that's the one card I didn't want. So you may cast any number of spells from those cards while pay. Oh no. I exiled a Wheel of Sun and Moon, and this is actually a good card that you want for yourself. And you gain one treasure token from the Negan trigger. So who are you attacking and what are you attacking?
I'm just straight up attacking you.
Rude. So for 4 plus 6, 10. Neon's a 6. Oh, God. 16 damage. Wow. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There we go. And there's another 6 commander off of Neon. Oof. I'll take it. And is there anything else? Alrighty. Go ahead and untap. I will.
Wasn't I supposed to create another walker token?
Yes.
So you sacrificed a creature?
Yes. Oh, great.
Okay.
Awesome. Not this. I'll tap for two, play a rampant growth, and search for a plains. Put it into the battlefield tapped. There it is. And what else? I have 4 left to spare. And both of my stuff cost 5. Great. I will plus 1. This is Johnny. We'll look at the top 4. I have a Johnny sleeper agent in my reveal. Now I have him in my hand. And then I'll plus 1 this a Johnny to 5. And then give a Dorn Pouncer +1/+1. And, your Negan and, Italy on the Wrath should be, tapped, babe.
Oh.
Shoot. How much is that, walker?
2.
2? Shoot. Alright. I will send the Adorned Pouncer and Mage's Attendant your way. Trigger off the Arabo. Put +3/+3 on the Mage's Attendant. So you have a 6/5 and a 2/2 coming your way. And the Adorned Pouncer has double strike, which is like first strike, but like double it.
How much is the card on the right?
2/2 with double strike. So essentially another 4/4.
Okay, I block that one with Primal Storm.
Primal Storm is tapped, babe.
Oh yeah, that's right. Actually, I'll just take the hit.
Alright, so then you'll be taking 10 damage.
Okay.
And... I will end my turn then. All your stuff untaps.
I drew a card, right?
Yes.
Okay. Could I sacrifice all these in one go as Lance?
Yes, you can if you want.
Okay. Sacrificing as a plane.
You can just say like sacrifice this treasure for any mana of any color, and you know, is basically what treasures are there for.
And this one for the same. And I play Debt to the Deathless.
Death to the Deathless. Loads. There goes. Debt to the Deathless. Each opponent loses. Oh. Babe, you should probably tap out for this.
What do you mean?
I would tap out, because X is literally as much mana you can put into it, outside of its casting cost.
Okay. I'll tap every.
So, how much including... So, how much, mana do you have to put into it?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11.
11, so minus the casting cost, which is 4, so it would be 7. Then I would lose 14 life, and you would gain 14. So you'd be at 24.
And I would like to attack with
You can literally kill me right now.
With everything.
And that's game. GG.
Yay.
I forgot I had put that into your deck. Wow. God damn it. Oh. That's not what I wanted to do. Join now. Oof. Flip. Reset. Yes.
It's almost 2 here.
Do you want to stop now then?
Yeah, I gotta get Christmas stuff done.
Alrighty. See you later, babe. Have fun.
See ya.
Love you.
Love you too.
Goodbye.
Bye.
And that was Cats getting destroyed by Negan. I have a short stream today. But that was mostly from working around Wendy's schedule today. You know, like she said, she was busy and had to do things with her family today, and so I had to do something kind of quick or a little bit time-consuming before she had to go. So I'm glad. She's getting a little bit better with her Negan deck. Can't wait to see if she'll expand a little bit more. I have a fairy deck that I'm actually making for her. I'm sure she'll love that. Kind of, it's almost like the reverse of Negan. It's the Alayla fairy enchantress deck. Or it's not. Well, it is a can be an enchantress deck, but I don't really use it. I just use it for fairies. I pulled some nice cards today. Got my butt beat by my girlfriend. So I think all is right in the world right now. What should I do now? Should I do anything or should I just end here?
is a good question. I don't really have anything else planned today. I was actually kind of expecting, at least one more game, but I'm fine with, today's events. I think whatever I want. The fresh hell is this? Let's go over here. Let's do some how to drink videos just to run out the time. Just chill and relax.
It's April 19th. That's the day before April 20th, which is also known as 420, which is... Well, it's 420. So one of the things that's been on my mind for a while is that CBD has been showing up in cocktails. And CBD, of course, I'm referring to cannabidiol extract, cannabidiol. So it's been showing up in cocktails in major markets. And I felt like we should talk about putting it into cocktails. And, well, what better day is there to do it? And the other thing I've been thinking about is the Lord of the Rings. Entdraft is a beverage that I haven't done.
And I'll be right back. I'm going to grab some snacks. Kind of hungry right now.
So we're doing Entdraft for 420 for all you Ents out there.
There was this large barrel full of pipeweed, and we smoked all of it.
I'm using FX CBD, which is processed from hemp. I think, if I'm not mistaken, that makes it legal in every state.
Not some check mix.
Be marijuana, recreationally legal state. There's definitely other CBDs on the market. I've sampled this with different CBD oils. It's tough. They all have a little bit different flavors. This one in particular, I like a lot. It tastes a lot like green tea. The rest of this drink is unassuming enough.
So how did everyone like the... Magic stream so far,
really,
or
kind of be front and center in this
as much as it, that
is
happened.
Entdraft is,
I liked it.
The beverage,
like I said, Winnie's getting better, and I can't wait for her to play her fairy deck when I go visit her this winter or this Christmas.
I am an Ent.
Brewed from the waters of the Entwash, which is a river that runs through Rohan and the Fangorn Forest. Its tributaries are the spring waters of the Methedras, which is the southernmost mountain of the Misty Mountains. Misty Mount, of course, of Hobbit fame, and also of, Led Zeppelin fame. But Gollum, with a evil one, crept away with hey-ya, hey-ya, hey-ya. That's how that song goes, exactly. It's a perfect, 100% uncanny impression of Robert Plant.
It was kind of slow. I'm sorry, then. With Wendy, I have to like take it a little bit slow to try to explain
or
how my cards work.
Laboratory would
and
that. I can't say
along with Kitaro, I know he's been wanting to play some magic as well, but I'm trying to get him into it and try to explain it. So I kind of had to do it like a basic newbie kind
of
way.
Do a lot of good for you in the Lord of the Rings. If you're a hobbit, it'll make you as tall as a not hobbit.
You're what, 3'6" at the most? Whereas me, I'm pushing 3'7".
Learned a bit. Oh, that's good.
3'8".
The description of the flavor is like a cool breeze coming out of the forest. So I'm thinking mossy, kind of earthy flavors. And we're in luck because the CBD oil does a lot of that work for us in this case. I'm gonna make this drink with Jameson whiskey. I don't know what JRR's preferred brand was, but, or if he was a teetotaler, I have no answer to that question.
I do plan on doing
collab
for Commander Kingdom in the future, or at least try to. I know at least two of the people online to collab with know how to play.
The next ingredient I want to use is a little of this Amaro.
And, everyone else is like a newbie.
I actually think that this is
as I'm aware.
Just delicious stuff, a little seltzer. It's just going to add a little bit more character to this. I want to somewhere between a quarter and a half an ounce. I leave that kind of as a dealer's choice. I'm going to split the difference exactly in my jigger. Yeah, you know, it's up to taste, right? And now I'm gonna add an eyedropper full of my CBD oil. I'll admit, that's not the most accurate measurement. Now, I like to add this here, and I like to stir it in. You are well within the bounds of normalcy to add this after the drink is mixed and have it be...
It's always nice to have fresh faces to this hobby.
Stirred in the glass. So, CBD? One of the things I want to do is...
Yeah, he mentioned it just a bit ago, what it was.
My hand will allow. And sadly, I've got a little...
He's talking about the oil that he just put into that,
because although I'm not going to emulsify that oil and get it suspended all the way through the drink, I do want to break it up and get it as distributed as I can. It's gonna look really neat when this is all said and done, though, I hope. Okay, now I'm gonna pour this into my glass. And here we have my Ent draft. I would like to garnish that. A little sprig of rosemary, fresh rosemary, literally from a plant. Clap that off a little bit. All right, Ent draft.
Yeah, at the beginning of this how to drink video, Katara, who talks about how he's been noticing that some people have been doing it more and more frequently to the point that he wants to get in on the fun.
What have I got in my pocket?
Oh my god, that's fucking delicious. I know there's not a lot going on in that drink, but yeah, what a lovely evolution. I gotta say, guys, I think I nailed it with this one. The whiskey and the Amaro Chiochiaro. So Amaro Chiochiaro, it's an Amaro, right? It's a bitter, it's an aperitif, but it's got a little bit of sweetness to it. It does have that in there. And so in the way that an old fashioned has a little bit of sweetness, so too does this. But it's everything, these are really mellow.
You can get high from CBD?
The Jameson,
I'm not
rounded notes.
A
really
stoner,
no,
so I'm not quite aware
in the face,
of
kind of,
those
overpowering
sort of
flavors
or
present here. And so our CBD oil can really kind of shine. Let me do these tasting notes. First off, the nose, rosemary, and the CBD, actually. And it does have kind of a damp, mossy, forest kind of earthy vibe in the nose, which is just so cool. Okay, and we'll go for a sip. A little bit of like sweet kind of caramel notes quickly giving way to like a grassy green tea kind of flavor.
So CBD is just for flavor? Yep.
And then,
from
and
what
then
my understanding.
And then all of a sudden you start getting weird sort of stone fruit like cherries. But like buttery cherries at the very end there. And honestly, I really like this drink. I gotta say, a lot of times, you know, when you set out to create a real life version of a fictional beverage, sometimes you come up with something that's true to the fiction that isn't a great drink. I actually think this is a great drink on its own. It's very simple. You know, there's three ingredients and a garnish.
On work,
it
I see a bit of CBD product. Oh, nice. Where do you
like
work at? Crandall?
Dog. Mysterious forest, and I think that just is really, honestly, it's perfect. I actually really like it so much. Oh my god! So that's how to drink the show. I'm making cocktails and how to drink them. I'm on Twitter at How to Drink. I'm on Instagram at How to Drink. I have a Patreon at patreon.com/How to Drink. Oh, hello there. I didn't see you come in. Come along on my adventure in drinks I've never had before, on How to Drink. I have an occasional series that I do on Patreon. It's a Patreon exclusive. I call it Drinks I've Never Had Before, or Dyna for short. And I'm gonna do a little taste of that here today. This drink I've heard about a lot of, called the Star Cocktail. I've never had it before. I haven't tested it at all. I've got an entry here on page 272 of David Wondrich's Imbibe. Book is available in a link below in the comments. And we're just going to make the sucker. It's a great history piece here, but the important bits is that we should fill a mixing glass with half full of ice, 2 dashes of gum syrup, 3 dashes of Peychaud's or Angostura bitters, 1/2 jigger of apple brandy, 1/2 jigger of Italian vermouth. Mix it, strain it in a cocktail glass with a twist of small piece of lemon peel on top. Mr. Wondrich goes on to explain that he prefers Angostura here, and that Harry Johnson suggests adding a dash of curacao.
I'd say so. That's good.
There's also a Manhattan Club version, which involves yellow chartreuse and cherry bounce. I don't have any yellow chartreuse, so I'm not even going to venture into that territory. So without further ado, let's try this drink, the Star Cocktail, that I've never had before. It's interesting. I think that, if I'm not mistaken, he says in another section that at one time, the only two drinks he knew of, I think it's Under the Jersey Sunset, that involved Applejack were the Star Cocktail and the Jack Rose. So, and I've never had a Star Cocktail, so I'm excited to try it. It sounds good. It's sort of like a Applejack version of a Manhattan. Okay, so now the book says we should start with the ice in the glass. I don't really see any benefit to that, so I think we'll start with not the ice in the glass. We're gonna start with the vermouth. We're gonna do an ounce and a half of our delicious Antica Formula. I believe this is the style of vermouth that is referred to in the book when it says Italian vermouth. At the very least, I'm pretty sure it's got to be a sweet red vermouth. Maybe a Puntamez would be correct, but I can't think that we're going very wrong.
8 hours before a PC.
I have an ounce and a half of Laird's Bottled and Bond apple brandy. Truly, we might be better with an older Laird's Applejack, but as this is drinks I've never had before, I really didn't even know I was making this drink until about 3 minutes ago. So I'm going with what I happen to have in stock, and I'm fresh out of the 12 and 7 year apple brandy. I think
as long as it's a good pay, I'm pretty sure it's worth it.
I have my gum syrup here.
Sounds pretty neat.
This isn't really a dash or top. I suppose I could put a dash on it. It's interesting that in a lot of these older books, they talk about dashes with something like gum syrup.
Are you working right now?
So
or
I don't even understand how you dash it. So I dash when it asks for a dash from a bar spoon. I think I do this kind of a little visual thing, an ocular pat down, if you will. That's like a dash, I think. It's not quite the whole bar spoon. I think that's two dashes. So we're going to put in three dashes of Angostura bitters. And at that, we're going to need some ice. This ice up.
Oh.
So I haven't even, I'm over here. The olfactory
element. Oh, wow. I had no idea what time it was for me.
Really strong.
I wasn't
already
paying attention.
And it's just such fresh and apple-y. Essence of apple just smells really nice.
Like 4 p.m. for me right now. Wow. Where am I from? I'm from America. Specifically the United States. How about you, Grando? Where are you from? Are you from, I'm guessing Europe? I'm
lemon?
Going to guess.
There's the Star Cocktail. Let's see how it is. I'm excited, actually. Lemon is a dominant part of the nose, and I'm a little bit disappointed by that because honestly, up until
nice.
I added the lemon, I was really smelling the apple essence. And if I were to make this again, and this is the first time I've had it, I might actually rethink that lemon twist thing, even though the book calls for it, because I miss that. I like that apple essence. Wow, that's so freaking great, man. It is so...
From Germany? Nice.
What? That is a surprising drink. That's incredible. It's a really long evolution in this drink. I was not expecting anything like that. That is so good. So, somehow... Oh my God, that's so cool.
How's the weather in Germany right now?
The combination of Antica and the Applejack. The lead notes is actually like bitter chocolate. Like a very dark chocolate right away. And then that eventually fades into like that apple essence, but not like what it tastes like when you bite into an apple, but what you would imagine like distilled and concentrated apple perfume stripped of all of its sugars to taste like an
Old
apple
way.
That just effuses and permeates
you.
your
where I live is going to be like that real factory, in really about a month.
Hits you. And then that gives way. It's a really neat drink. Yeah, a dark chocolatey, bittery kind of thing, but in a sweet, pleasant way.
Typical winter weather.
That yeah.
Apple kind of thing, sort of, with a little bit of lemon in it, and gives way to a kind of caramelly sweetness. That is really cool.
Yeah, but Kataro awesome. Has it better than us since he lives in Texas. It's just all nice and warm and sunny and down there.
Ooh, and then there's like a vegetable thing. I've been hearing some weird winter
weather changes has been happening.
It kind of has a very long
where Kataro lives.
The volume gets turned way down, but it keeps playing for a long time. What a surprising drink. And I was prepared to have to do all kinds of improvements here, because a lot of times when I do these drinks I've never had before, I drink it, I'm like, it's not so great, but let's try some other stuff. It's not going to happen today. This drink is great. I will try Harry Johnson's dash of Curacao in the glass. And this is a thing that I'll do just out of interest of completion. We're going to do a very light, like, light. That's a dash. That's definitely a dash. At least it's a dash that my dashers would supply. I'm curious. I actually think that this is going to be a mistake. I think it's going to actually... Well, not a mistake. I'll explain. Let me taste it. Yeah. So that makes the drink a lot more approachable and more accessible, I think. But it does kind of pinch back a little bit of those dark chocolate notes I was getting in the lead that I was so surprised by. I could see how those could be that dark chocolate flavor that I was getting.
Not yeah, I hear you. I love chocolate. The winter weather. People. The only thing I don't like about
I was really surprised by it. I love being surprised.
Winter, though, is that oftentimes that leads to hazardous kind of road conditions.
Never anticipating is so wonderful to me. The Curacao kind of robs rain? That
same,
of the drink
dude.
A little bit.
Same.
So I would skip the Curacao on this one.
Love it's me some good rain.
I am curious about how that yellow chartreuse cherry bounce version works. I might have to try that one on the Patreon side. So David Wondrich says you should go with an older, like a 7 or 12 year old apple brandy from Laird's. I don't know. I think that maybe that's true if you were using a different vermouth, but this Antica Formula is so forceful in its flavor that the stronger, younger, brasher apple brandy kind of stands up to it. I imagine it's probably pairing better. If I was using a more reserved vermouth, maybe a more oaked apple brandy might make more sense. And I think that would be kind of a different drink, actually. It's an interesting thought. That is great. It's a great drink, real surprise. I made a star cocktail, equal parts applejack and vermouth, a couple dashes of bitters, a little bit of gum syrup, and we tried it with some curacao. It wasn't for me, actually. I wonder how that would be with chocolate bitters, really double down on the chocolate aspect of it. Usually that's a mistake, actually. Usually that throws things out of balance when you think, oh, more of that would be good. Nah, tends not to be true. I'm on Twitter at HowToDrink, I'm on Instagram at HowToDrink, I'm on Patreon at patreon.com/HowToDrink. And if you like stuff like this, me trying drinks I've never had.
Do one more video. Another thing I like about How to Drink is that he also does other drinks based off of fictional series, like, you know, like Scrubs, the TV show, or Destiny, the game. I'm curious what the Destiny drinks
Eyes
look
up,
like.
Eyes up, Guardians! I don't know what the right delivery on that is. See, I asked Ari David, also known as the Amazing Ari, what I should open this episode with, and he said definitely that, so I hope it worked. Today, I'm looking at the drinks in Destiny, the hugely popular first-person MMO from Bungie. And for your information, no, they didn't sponsor this. I just kind of felt like doing it, okay? You get this one for free, Bungie. For free. All right, so Destiny. Destiny's got these immortal space wizards that use the power of light. No, not like that. Battling to protect the last city on Earth from the forces of eternal darkness. Not like that. Kind of a dualistic Zoroastrian thing going slightly there, right? Yeah. So you play as a human, but like a dead slash immortal one, or an exo, which is an ancient humanoid self-aware thinking robot, or one of the Awoken, which is a group of, I'm not sure if they're aliens. I mean, they're descended from humans. They're human cousins. They left Earth a long time ago, like centuries. But like, I mean, how long can you stay away from Earth? And I personally, I would say that they're a different species by this point, but I think that would offend them. So we'll leave it alone. The long lost cousins, I guess. Anyway, and you get busy, live, die, repeating.
Then we better start over.
Oh, come on.
No, not that way. Your way through a pretty grim pitched battle for the continued existence of everything. Okay, if you need more background on the Destiny lore than I'm giving you here, this is the wrong show for you, because I'm here to make drinks from the game, and yes, there's a few drinks in it, or at the very least, drink-adjacent things that I can take inspiration from. But if you need that extra dose of lore, you probably want to check out My Name is Biff, because that's where I went. Thanks, Biff.
Biff.
Your name. By the way, I should let you know that if you are looking to pick up any of the bottles I'm using in this episode to try these at home, or if you just want to expand your home bar, you should check out Curiata using the link in the pinned comment below. They will have everything I'm using here, and they ship to most of the US states, and we are expanding that all the time. So if getting access to Italicus is tricky for you, or Maraschino, or Ricard, or any of the things I use on the show, check out Curiata. Drink.curiata.com or
in the Destiny 2 trailer. Didn't think there were more.
So yeah. When I started putting this episode together, I wasn't really sure what order to put the drinks in, but a lot of you seem to enjoy.
When it comes to myself, making so, drinks treat, based off of games, milk first. He does his research.
Some of you know what both a Vex and their milk is already, but in the interest of everyone else, I will now endeavor to explain the Vex and their Vex milk.
Vex milk.
Vex milk is a colloquialism used by the characters in the Destiny universe to describe the Radiolara fluid that contains the cognitive essence of the Vex, which are a collective consciousness of robots that are as old as the universe itself and live outside reality as paracausal entities.
Oh.
See, their bodies are these inert robotic frames that can't really do anything on their own until they're all filled up with the Vex milk, which contains the collective consciousness of the Vex.
Well,
mechanically, the fluid contains a suspension of silicoid structures 100 to 200 micrometers in size. It's called Radiolara fluid because the in-game human scientists who first identified it thought the little cells in it looked a lot like Radiolara protozoa, which are an actual real-world things here on Earth.
He often
why would you drink this?
Makes a parody drink of like
because
almost anything.
Vex kind of they consume and assimilate whatever they touch over time. So drinking Vex milk would turn you into a Vex. It's a touch like Captain Picard becoming Locutus of Borg. In game, touching Vex milk will hurt your character. In life, drinking Vex milk will probably hurt me. Because the in-world description of this stuff is that it is an alkaline solution of dense salts in water. And that does not sound great tasting, nor is it supposed to be great tasting. So, this is about to be a cursed cocktail. It's got this luminescent whitish look to it. And that, plus unpleasant, was really the recipe touchstone.
You know, for a second, I thought he was describing
the juice. The effect of absinthe, Ricard, or Ouzo struck me as having the right look, and probably not as a bad place to start on taste, to be honest. In my experiments, and yes, I had to develop and taste this already, sadly, I found that Ricard was the best, and I use that term loosely here, in my mixing glass. In my mixing glass. I'm going to combine 1 ounce of Ricard.
That's what Vex milk looks like. Yeah, doesn't it?
French pastis. Delicious. Careful now, boy. 1 ounce of Bailey's Irish cream. For that milky goodness. Who doesn't love a, well, actually, you know what? A Pernod cream, or like a absinthe cream on mussels is actually, it's like a nice way to do them. I like mussels, they're good. And 4 dashes of this saline solution, which is made by combining 20 grams of salt to 80 grams of water. So it's pretty darn salty stuff. 1, 2, 3,
salt,
4.
Salt, water, dasher.
Oh joy. I'm going to put some ice in here because it is a small mercy that I do get to dilute it some. Stir that up. Bar spoon's kind of fighting me. I don't love this one. It's just this is not my favorite bar spoon. This is the wrong length of a bar spoon. We're in trouble. My hand is getting tired because of it. I'm going to put it in this glass. There it is. Glass of Radiolara fluid, otherwise known as Vex milk, so prepare to be assimilated, I suppose. Ooh, that's a fun aftertaste. So what does this taste like? Believe it or not, it's not as nightmarish as you would expect. Or as I was preparing for. It kind of tastes like chocolate with like an absinthe or with a licorice kick to it. And a lengthy, salty...
Did I watch The Drink Master on Netflix? I have not. I actually like you it. See, I'm not an alcoholic person. Uh-oh. But ever since,
No, it's really
Cyberpunk Edgerunners.
You have to like
the algorithm for YouTube suggested the licorice. It's like one of his how to drink videos, and I got curious, kind of watched it, and I fell down that rabbit
hole. Definitely, like it's not great. It is a jarring flavor. Jarring is definitely what it is because you're like, oh shit, what the hell am I drinking? But once you kind of get over that initial thing, it's not that bad. And then the salty finish, which does enhance some of the chocolatiness of the flavors, some of the carameliness of the flavors, really lingers. All of that to me feels like a pretty faithful answer to the Vex Milk question without, you know what, I'm not even gonna say it. I'm just not gonna say that. I'm just not gonna say that. I don't want that. I don't wanna record that for someone to use. Without, yeah. Anyway, not great. I am gonna say appropriate to Vex Milk, I think. Personally, I think I did it. I created Vex Milk. I'm a Vex. Fuck. Okay, so thankfully that is over, and I can move it right along here.
I don't drink alcohol, but the show was pretty good, and the presentation of drinks were.
Now, the Awoken. Yeah, that's how I felt about this YouTuber too. By the Queen Marisov, who, frankly, I just find her a bit suspicious. But maybe that's me. I don't know.
They will feel my wrath.
And they have this secret city that's outside of time, and they call it the Dreaming City. It's a broken, cursed place where time just repeats the same 3 weeks on a loop forever, which coincidentally makes for pretty good gameplay, it turns out. It's a funny coincidence there. As a guardian, you gotta go there and help out the Awokens or something. And to do that, you're gonna need access to the Ascendant Realms, which are pocket dimensions powered by pure darkness. And to get there, well, you're just gonna need to see yourself some little tears in reality. And to do that, you will probably definitely need to drink up some magic space drugs, okay? I didn't make the rules here, Bungie did. And the stuff I'm talking about is Tincture of Queen's Foil. Now, in the game, this thing only exists as a little icon in your inventory, so far as I know. Anyway, I've pulled some screen grabs and I looked real close, okay? What we've got here, it was a failure to communicate. Now, what we've got here is a semi-luminescent teal blue liquid with tendrils of darkness sort of suspended and coursing through it, trying to escape the vial. I'm not gonna lie, that is not easy to achieve in a cocktail. I worked on this one quite a bit to find something that would both look correct and be something you would actually want to drink. And I feel pretty good about what I've come up with, but there is a trick to this whole thing, and you'll need a pretty specialized ingredient. See, I can get something dark that would float on the drink, and I can get something dark that'll sink right through a drink and sit on the bottom. But to hang out in the middle, like tendrils, and stay there while you have this drink in your hand and you're moving around, maybe at a party or whatever, that's hard. After working on this for a while, I'd found a combination of flavors that I mostly liked, but I couldn't quite get the look right. And then I started playing with just straight up manipulating the viscosity. I had some xanthan gum from Modernist Pantry, and I'm gonna put a link to this below. And I tinkered with this a bit, and I arrived at a sort of non-standard use for it. See, Modernist Pantry has a pretty good formula they figured out for using this in a recipe, like for instance hot dog relish or something. But I wanted to work with it another way, because I didn't want to make one cocktail with it, right? I needed to make something I could add two drinks. Instead, I doubled their recommended ratio, and I mixed it with water to create a pourable thickener. And I can add this to any drink. This stuff in the bottle is, it's basically flavorless, although it's not quite colorless. That's really just kind of suspended air in there, I think, by the way. And actually, it's funny, when you shake it, you can see the air bubbles just stay where they landed.
Really?
You
can
dilute this into a cocktail and derive at a drink that would be subtly more viscous than you'd have otherwise, which lets you do pretty neat things. So Modernist Pantry recommends using 0.5 gram of xanthan gum to a liter of fluid at most. I use the full gram to a liter. I doubled the ratio. This is also my first real go-around with this, so maybe you all have better ratios or advice for using this stuff. And also, since I know you're going to ask, why am I not just using a gum syrup and take, like, gum acacia and some simple syrup? Well, for one, that ties our thickeningness to sweetness. And two, gum syrup isn't really that thick. right? It's not. So what would I do here? I would have to make a special version of gum syrup just for this drink that's like super over thickened. I didn't want to make an ingredient just for this drink. This is a thickener that you can add to other drinks. I think it just makes more sense to make a universal thickening agent like that that can be added to any drink in small
quantities. Yeah, not to be wasteful.
That is divorced from sweetness, right? You want this drink to be a little thicker, a little bit more viscous, you can just do that. I'll be using this a lot probably on the show. Well, maybe I won't when I overuse it, but boy, does this solve a lot of visual problems for me. So, in my mixing glass, I'm going to do a half an ounce of simple. A half an ounce of my thickener. And you can see it pours easily. It's not like glue, right? A quarter ounce of blue curacao. And honestly, you might even be able to get away with a little bit even less than that, but we'll do a quarter. Half an ounce of italicus, which is a bergamot liqueur. Bergamot, that's the primary ingredient, the flavoring agent in a Earl Grey tea.
Oh.
So this is going to have that kind of a vibe. Earl Grey tea felt very appropriate for something called Queen's Foil. Tincture of Queen's Foil. I like that stuff. It's available on Criada. Half an ounce of Citron vodka, mainly because I wanted to get some lemony flavors in here, and I don't want to use lemon juice. And an ounce and a half of a dry gin. Also felt pretty appropriate for something called Tincture of Queen's Foil. Okay, crack some ice in there.
Ooh. So then, how are you gonna get the tendrils in there? Like, you use bitters?
Perfect glass for this. A tall highball glass.
Oh.
Strain that straight in, no ice. I should probably say that what I had in here is doubled, right? Like, that's a huge amount for this drink. Now that we've got this in a glass, all we need to do is add our streaks of darkness. And I found Angostura bitters work the best here. Partially, yes, it's because they taste great in this drink, but also it's because they have a lot of pigment. I tried a few different dark rums and stuff like that, black rums. Nothing comes even close to this. They just kind of, everything diffuses and disappears. The trick, though, is to dash it down hard, because where it stops moving is pretty much where it's going to stay. So I'm going to put a few dashes in here, and hopefully this looks awesome. Ready? And there we have, well, that one actually rose up a little bit, but it does have some streaks going down there. There we have our tincture of Queen's Foil. Honestly, I think that's cool and unique enough looking that it really doesn't need a garnish. But you can see it definitely has streaks that reach all the way to the bottom. You can go more aggressive on that. You're going to get different results every time you do this, to be perfectly honest, slightly, because there's a little bit of randomness and chaos in this. So I don't think it needs a garnish. But now let's see if it'll help me find my way into the Ascendant Realms. It doesn't. I find that pretty pleasant. It does not feel, like, it does have a silky texture to it, but it does not have, like, a very heavy, thick, jello-y texture to it at all. I find it very, very drinkable. It is bright and lemony. Oh, that bergamot. I love that. I just love the taste of that bergamot, that Earl Grey flavor. The gin is not a major part of the flavor profile, to be perfectly honest. It is part of the orchestra.
Yeah, it does look good. It looks juniper, like blue Kool-Aid.
The herbalness to it, the little astringency that comes along with that, all of that sort of helps back it up. Would this be better with fresh lemon juice instead of the lemon vodka? But then we'd have to deal with lemon pulp being in there and stuff like that, and it would really ruin the look of the drink. But I think it's great as it is. And I think it tastes, it's like I said, it's an approachable, easy to drink. Your streaks will last. I mean, they're kind of fading now a little bit, but they're still in there. And you can always really kind of go crazy with it if you want. They won't mix on their own, right? They will remain separated. Quite sophisticated and regal tasting. And of course, the Angostura Bitters is bringing a lot of cinnamon and like sassafras-y even on this mix.
Sassafras?
The way that it's expressing out of there. Like root beer kind of flavors. I find that really enjoyable. It's cool. And I think... I think it looks the part, which is what I was going for. Next drink. Let's move it along. All right, we're back. Let's talk about the Fallen. Now, the Fallen are some bad guys in the game who used to be the best bros with the Traveler, and the Traveler ditched them when the darkness showed up, okay? And they're feeling hurt about it. So they showed up in the Soul System, and they're mucking around, and they're gonna
wreck up the place.
Okay, that's my opinion on the whole situation. Also, they're utterly dependent on this stuff called Aether to survive.
Devil Aether.
not that kind of ether. And they have these giant eyeball robot servitors that make it for them. These dudes love robots. Love them. Also, it's not their fault, but because I think they have trouble breathing or something, the sounds of their voices, their raspy, wheezing breathing, makes my skin crawl. And it triggers my misophonia hard, I guess, because I'm a terrible person. So, the Fallen, or Elixni, if you prefer, they absolutely need ether to survive. And the more of it they have, the bigger and harder they survive. But for us humans and other folk, their ether is just kind of a real good time in a glass, if you know what I mean, eh?
Ooh, yeah.
So much so that there's a Fallen nightclub called The Empty Tank, where I'm pretty sure they serve ether. I don't think you get to see what the ether looks like in there when it's being served, but when you shoot these guys, they kind of explode in a cloud of the stuff, which is what I'm actually going off of for the recipe. So it's a sort of pale, nearly white, but slightly violet.
Let's go, cloud of stuff.
Wispy gas cloud. Got it, okay. We can do that, sort of. I won't lie, I did start this drink using a Ramos Gin Fizz template here, right? And I just kind of kept tinkering and with it and bending it until it was both what I thought the ether should look and taste like, and also something I don't think I've quite seen before, technique or appearance-wise. So this is gonna be a shake and drink. So in your tin, get yourself an ounce of lemon juice, for starters. And I have a lemon right here. And I got a knife. And I use my knife.
Love to play as a Fallen in Destiny.
Cut my lemon.
Yeah, that'd be a nice option for character creation. Kind of like how Bungie in Halo 2 allowed you to play as an Arbiter.
Just like that, just so. Quarter ounce of simple syrup. Here goes the quarter ounce of simple syrup. It's this one. This one's very sticky. We need some.
I'm surprised 343 or even Bungie hasn't done anything like that since then. It's all just been like main character, Master Chief.
It's a potent flavor, and you can easily overdo it. So I'm gonna go somewhere between a quarter and a half an ounce. Some of you said something like, oh, that's a third of an ounce. That's a third. It's not. It's a different number. That's okay. Creme de violet and half an ounce of maraschino liqueur.
Yas.
And 2 ounces of London.
Whatever happened to Arbiter, by the way?
Giant using aviation.
Is he dead? Because, like, we never see or hear about him again. Don't. Is he just forgotten about now?
Now
even though he was just a major factor.
Greg, you say, why aren't you dry shaking first? Well, I will.
Two and three.
If you let me. Now, take your strainer, strain the drink back from one tin to the other. Pull the coil off your strainer, throw it into your tin. Once again, using Modernist Pantry, we're going to use a little of their foam magic. This is maltodextrin, methylcellulose, and xanthan gum mixed together. I've used this on the show before, like when I did the Blackie
really?
Sucker Punch. A link below.
I didn't know that.
But I haven't used it in a shaker like
this. And again,
I
didn't play that much of Halo 4, and I never played Halo 5.
Long way. So like that amount on your bar spoon, put that in there, okay? Just a tiny amount. Tiny amount goes a long way, like a quarter of a bar spoon. And now, with our spring in there, we will do this reverse dry shake and shake like crazy. Strain that.
So how does it get
science fiction looking glass?
Messy then. In Halo 4, only in cutscene in the end of thing. Oh wow, that's kind of a
pop
shame.
Pop out a little club soda. I think that's a perfect representation of a cloud of ether in a glass.
Oh, I see why it's called that.
I really like that. I love what the creme de violet is doing there. It brings this floral, flowery. I mean, the texture of the drink too, you're almost inhaling it more than drinking it because the whole thing is froth, right? Like all the way to the bottom. It is tart and floral and light and effort floaty. It's like a breath of air. The whole texture of it is a very big part of the experience because it does have the like you're drinking a lot of air.
343 made a weird time jump from Halo 5 to Halo Infinite. I heard that. Ain't it like 10 years?
The footage from the
and
game,
then they just killed off Cortana off screen or something like that. So you have this new Cortana.
You know, this purplish, lemony tart, somewhat, I mean, drinkable, very drinkable, not overly sweet, but drinkable. Gin, floral, oh, explosion. I wouldn't lie, it's good. That's good. I think that's quite enjoyable. There it is. It looks like a big, white, billowy, puffy cloud in there. I love that. Just perfect foam. Very good. So I want to say I started out with this being like based off of a Ramos Gin Fizz. Ramos Gin Fizz has heavy cream in it, and it does this thing when you add seltzer to it where it builds a crazy, thick, dense head that can extend way past the top of the drink. This won't do that because it doesn't have heavy cream.
Entirely off screen.
Differently, right? But I didn't want it to do that. Because I wanted this to be
shame
airy.
That they
I wanted it to
off.
Be more vaporous. Honestly, if I could, I would have gotten like, what is that? Like an ultrasonic transducer and literally made it into vapors so that you would inhale it instead of drinking it. Don't do that. That's unsafe. So that wasn't what I was going for, and that's why I went with the Shook Foam Magic versus heavy cream, so that it wouldn't be thick and heavy. I wanted it to break apart and be airy and have big bubbles in it and just sort of like float. I wanted it to be a lot of air. There we have it. Ether, as they might serve at the Fallen Tank. Well, Guardians, I hope you enjoyed this episode. Honestly, I haven't played Destiny. I did a lot of research on Destiny, and I had a lot of help doing a lot of research on Destiny. Ari David, the amazing Ari, gave me a big lift on this one. I'm going to have a link down there to his Twitch. Yeah, he streams Destiny at least once a week. And he's also, of course, plays Cyberpunk Red with us on Greg from HTD, which is my Twitch on Tuesday nights, currently at 7 p.m.
Can I play the campaign one time? See, I never even played the campaign. I've always just been doing the multiplayer ever since they announced it for free. And then, yeah, I just never really had time going into the campaign, especially when they announced day one that co-op wasn't a thing. And right now, I don't think co-op is still a thing either. Kind of disappointed on 343 part. But, you know, hopefully something gets fixed in the future. Somebody takes Halo in a proper direction or whatnot. So I think we're going to be going raiding now. And I'm kind of on a cross between Eli and Kane. Eli is playing Resident Evil 2. And Kane right now is playing Dead by Daylight. To whom should I raid? Good question. I can always roll a die for it. Where's my D20s at? Odds, Eli, evens, Kane. I rolled a 6, so it's Kane it is. Not to go anyways? Aw, that's a shame. Well, thank you for joining. Hope you have a good day. And I hope you have a wonderful tomorrow. If I don't see you again, good afternoon, good evening, and good night. Thank you. See you next time. Catch you again. Bye-bye.